investors hang out. We are at the fag end of 2018. How should we describe this year? Well, a year of turmoil. And what do we expect in 2019 is what we will discuss in today's Investors Hangout, brought to you by Aditya Birla, Sun Life Mutual Fund and Value Research. With me is the CEO of Value Research, Dhirendra Kumar. Dhirendra, welcome.
Thank you.
How would you term 2018 as a year? I just mentioned it as a year of anxiety. Would you agree with me, or a year of turmoil? Would you agree with that? Or would you like to coin it as something else?
No, I would agree with all of it. Anxiety, turmoil, hope, hopes not materializing, all of that. But, but at the same time, there is nothing unusual about it. It is like this only. Yes, we got some surprises. When and that is primarily expectations, the built-up expectations which did not materialize, and it is a very cyclical thing. If you look at what was 2017, when equity funds generally went up by 40-45%, small cap funds went up by 50-55%, it raised huge expectations. That is where investors were putting money, expecting that, this thing will actually extend and it will repeat in 2018 too. That did not happen. And it is always like that, the reversion to mean. 2018 has been, has been a year of anxiety on one other front, which was extremely disappointing. Fixed income funds, particularly the liquid fund, we keep talking in our discussion, we have kept talking all through the year that when you have money for a couple of weeks, couple of days, put your money in liquid fund and forget about it, not to worry. It became worrisome. Few liquid funds went down in value because of the ILNFS crisis. So that was one thing. But otherwise, I think, 2018, I think it's a great year. I would say that it is a maturing of Indian investors. We have seen all this anxiety turmoil, and individual investors kept putting their SIP money. Not only that, the scale of SIP money coming into mutual fund has grown every month, despite all the disappointment. Which it has never happened in the past. Mutual funds used to get money only when the going is good. Bad times, people cancel their SIPs, take their money out, they start cursing only to vow that, they will not come back again for a couple of years or forever. Nothing of that sort happened. And which I think is a great foundation for individual investors, because if you take a long-term view, if you continue your investments in the bad times, you are unlikely to be disappointed, because investing isn't a game. Is it a game which you have to win the 2018 season? It is something, which is far more crucial. You have to win you have to achieve your financial goals. They are in critical goals, non-negotiable ones, child's education, your retirement money, accumulating for the down payment of your house. These are goals, and you really have to look at it like that. It's not a game that you have to win every year, and it isn't a match.
Okay, you say that this is not a game, but RBI and governments, not seeing each other eye to eye, and the slowing earning growth period, weak global markets, this is something that doesn't happen every year. Surely global weak markets can happen, but then that the disagreement between the RBI and the government, for example, we don't expect that to happen every year. Having said that, we also see that there is a momentum being gained in the SIP, somewhere around 9,000 crore per month. Yeah, there's a month. So will that momentum be sustained in the coming year? Is there a good, and we can go forward now and take it on from there, or something will derail this movement?
I would say that, all these things, if you look at all the negatives, RBI and government spat, corporate earnings not going up, oil prices going up, rupee depreciating. These are very usual things every few years. Of course, it doesn't happen all the time, but it happens every few years. And there is nothing unusual about it.
Okay.
One thing is that, rupee will depreciate whenever oil prices go up sharply. Because that is our biggest import bill. That apart, rupee will always depreciate over a period of time because the interest rate differential in the Indian market or and globally is so high that to remain competitive, we will have to depreciate by 3-4%, 5% every year. It doesn't happen in a nice smooth line.
Mm.
If it doesn't happen for 2-3 years, it will happen with a lag. And that is what happened. So I don't think, you know, when I take a long-term view from the context of investing for my retirement or investing for a couple of years, these are times when investors are doing the right thing. In fact, if I look at if you look at the scale of SIP, 2018 has been the most, you know, FIIs have pulled out money. And in 2018, their net inflow, there has been a net outflow, not an inflow.
Mm.
And if you compare it, you know, and despite that, the market hasn't crumbled. Reason being, SIP money has been able to match the FII outflows.
Mm.
So that, I think, is a great news.
So the resilience of the domestic market.
Yes, resilience of the domestic market. And
is something to be lauded.
Absolutely. Mm. And, you know, if you look at some of the fundamental changes happening to the market, and it has happened in the last 2-3 years, EPFO has started putting in money. Today, their investment comes every month. And that is, you know, in 1.5 years or 2 years' time, the index fund in which they invest the money has turned out become the largest Indian equity fund,
okay.
The Nifty ETF.
Mm.
If you look at the NPS money, which is scaling up substantially, and now 14% of contribution will come, you know, last week this was a change. This is also regular money. Money which will come into the market to stay there for a very, very long time and keep coming every month. So I think, you know, fundamental changes happening to the market. GST is streamlined now. Now we get a report that about 1 lakh crore comes by way of taxes on GST, on account of GST every year. So when I look at the cleaning up of the system, the organized businesses becoming the mainstay or coming on the forefront, fundamental changes happening to the economy, there will be beneficiaries, there will be, you know, there will be losers, there will be, you know, failures. But overall, if we are going to be a better economy, if we are going to be a more profitable economy, if our companies are going to become, you know, if we are going to have better future, which undoubtedly, you know, some of these fundamental, some of these foundational things happening will take a couple of years to show. Despite that, I think the bigger trouble is that, you know, some of the businesses itself are facing disruption because of technological changes.
Right.
That has always been the case. You can always say that, you know, all the big changes, cell phone led to the demise of the landline network. And so, you know, now we are witnessing such changes far more rapidly, much faster. Those are bigger issues, how companies will navigate the change, which is happening in an unanticipated way. If you look at, you know, the electric vehicle, they're insignificant part today, but it looks very clear that in 5 years' time, it could be a completely different, environment we might be in. If you look at, you know, the way the consumer has shifted from the cable TV network or the television, the content programming, that is undergoing a transformational thing. People are becoming choosy, and, you know, those changes are far more significant.
So should I deduce from this that the Indian investor is now a mature lot? And now they're ready to face any eventuality that happens, or rather they understand the eventuality that's going to be happening in the market. Would you say that we're ready for change?
I would say that, you know, indeed some Indian investors have chosen to, you know, appreciate or have you know, are beginning to appreciate equity. They understand how to benefit from it. And it is still early days,
okay.
Very few investors, because 9,000 crore every month coming in a country of this scale is insignificant. But it's a good beginning. It has happened from zero. So this, I think, is very significant. And good idea catches like
fire. So, Dhirin, are listening to you, do you think that the market in 2018 had no clear direction? Nifty or, you know, large cap barely returned anything, small caps bled, and that was a major concern for the investor. What do you think about it going forward? Is this a right time to invest in small caps?
I would say that, you know, your long-term money should be invested in equity.
Okay.
Depending on what kind of investor you are, if you're a first-time investor, start with a balanced fund. If you are an investor who has believed in equity, understands what small cap is, you can withstand or stomach that big decline that comes in the way. Always go, you know, have a larger allocation to small cap. But small cap is not meant for everybody. It's meant for that mature investor who has experienced market and is not the only money. Otherwise, the simple rules remain the same. And I don't think in any of our hangout session we are going to change those rules at all. Put your long-term money in equity, diversify, and never invest at one go. If you follow these three things and tilt it to large caps, to small caps, only if you have been in the market for 5 years, you know,
you understand
it. Go down in value substantially, and you will still not panic.
Okay. A big event that's coming in 2019 is about the general elections. Now, what repercussions can that have on the investor's life? Should they be worried? What should they be doing?
It might sound counterintuitive, but you know, elections don't matter when it comes to businesses.
Okay.
In fact, continuance of this government will only reinforce that there will be greater continuity. Actually, we have not seen big shift in economic policies. Only the speed of or expediency is visible. You know, if you look, so much has been talked about Aadhaar, so much has been talked about GST, so much has been talked about how we should, you know, if you look at all the changes that have come in our economy since 1990, if you look at some of the bigger things, the de-licensing, look at the freeing of the monetary policy,
right,
or the interest rates,
right,
which for 50 years we never had. So interest rates now change. If you look at the, you know, starting of NPS, moving from defined pension system to, you know, contributory pension system. If you look at all the big things, all these changes have been executed irrespective of the government. Those big policies don't change, only the speed of things happening, perception of corruption, the ability of a government which is in majority to do things with speed and, you know, with confidence, that changes. So I would say that, you know, it won't matter to the market if we have a government which has a majority. It will be disappointing for the market a little bit, but I think it is going to be only sentiments, because, you know, the primary driver of businesses is if they make more money, they'll be valued higher, and irrespective of the government.
You said it very rightly. If you make money, it doesn't matter who comes into power.
Big economic policies, we don't see a big change in the direction.
So what should my strategy be in the year 2019?
Same as it was in 2018 or 2017.
Continue.
Hmm? Yeah, make sure. You know, one has to really absorb this and absorb this. I sound like a stuck record, but you know, you are generally in two phases of your life. A phase in which you are accumulating your savings and a phase in which you are taking money out of your accumulation. You are converting a cash flow into a capital or deriving cash flow out of the capital created. You have to follow that the money which is not needed for a couple of years should be in equity. Money which you need it in near term should never be in equity. You will be in for a great disappointment. If somebody just drifted in the market in 2017 and got attracted to small caps, is in for a nasty surprise. And I think he'll be driven out of the market, or maybe they have gone out, never to come back again. And that is the wrong thing. So benefiting from equity is take that view, do these two, three things, and it will benefit you. I would say that in 2019, investors should look at their investment values or investment portfolio values less often, because it is going to be a very noisy year. Noisy because election, you know, the build up to the elections is always noisy.
Right.
The emergence of the new media and you know, the intensity of the media coverage only causes greater anxiety. But that is not, you know, you have to really think that when you invest in a mutual fund and the mutual fund manager invests in 30 businesses, one of the businesses happens to be Maruti Udyog, other happens to be ICICI Bank, something else, a lot of people get up in the morning to avail the product and services of those companies. And is that going to change? Are companies going to stop making money? It has happened in the past. We have seen some knee-jerk reaction to some news, such news, and that is always counterproductive.
Right.
Remain invested, remain fully invested in equity for your long-term money, and ignore the noise.
And what about the geopolitical situation worldwide and the oil and all that? That is going to impact the sentiments, surely.
It'll impact the
so be ready for the volatility in 2019 as well.
You know, you really don't take decisions because oil prices go up. You don't stop driving car. Likewise, you shouldn't, you know, things will readjust.
Stop investing.
Realign.
Hmm.
I don't think, you know, it is possible for people. In fact, if you are observed, you know, I would say that this is where selectivity, you know, the course that you take becomes crucial. If you are the nervous investor, never invest in an all equity fund. Invest in the balanced fund, and that is good enough for you.
Okay.
It will be a compromise of 2% over a 20-year period, but that is still okay. You will still be deriving 80% of the benefits of equity, and you will you will never be unnerved. If you are the kind who can really stomach reasonable volatility and you will not be upset with that, go for an all equity fund.
Okay.
Fairly well diversified. What we keep saying, the tax saving funds and the multi caps. If you are fine, you know, if you have experience, want to really maximize your return, have a 40% allocation to small caps.
Okay.
I don't think this will change as years change.
So what Dhiren is saying is have grit and determination and go for your investments and go for your SIPs as regularly as possible. Right, Dhiren?
Yeah.
Absolutely. Okay, we move on to the Q&A part of our program. And the first question is from A.K. Agarwal. And he says, considering the volatility, again, the question comes in the market, it being an election year, should I invest in balanced advantage fund? And I'm a retired person.
Yes, absolutely. You know, retired people, they need to be in equity because otherwise your capital will lose its value because the return that you get, the interest income that you earn many years doesn't really match inflation. Many years it does not beat inflation or barely matches inflation. And after you pay taxes on the interest earned because interest is taxable, your capital is going down. And if you consume all the return which you have derived on a deposit by way of interest, then 5 years down the line, your capital will remain constant. And that the income from that will not be good enough for you to support your income needs.
Okay.
So you need to be in equity. How to be in equity? Because when you retire, you become a little less confident. Your cash flow, your income stops. So you need to do it in a manner that you can easily navigate through. You will not get upset. And balanced advantage fund is a good way for most people for your long-term money. And it will not disappoint you the way equity does or the way small caps do.
Okay. Next question is from Atin, and it says, I'm 40 years old. I have a responsibility of a special child needs and a liability of a home loan. How should I plan my finances? Is it
invest.
A tax advantage for a special
little
child?
Bit, but you know, that is not the primary thing. If you have to really ensure for a 40-year-old person who has to ensure that he will leave enough state which will support the needs of a child with special needs, then you need to really create a corpus which is larger. Invest as much as possible, aggressively, in equity. And don't get unnerved, because having more than enough is the only way to ensure that you will leave a state which will ensure that the child will not outlive that savings, that investments. And so till you don't have the need for income to support that child, till you are working, then invest as aggressively and as much as possible. And when you get to a stage where you will not be able to support, or if you are not around, then work on a trust structure. Appoint one or two trustees. Make sure that, you know, that corpus moves into an investment which is easy, you know, a low maintenance portfolio, maybe 2-3 balance fund or some such thing. It depends on the scale and the need for income. Once you have that, have one or two, you know, trustees who will ensure that if you're not around, then that income will be derived, which will be used for the needs of the child.
Benefit of the child.
So keep it, try and keep it as simple as possible.
And invest, as he said, aggressively.
Invest aggressively in equity. You need an all equity portfolio, and having that margin of error is the only insurance.
Okay. After the recent changes in NPS, its tax implications have reduced. So does it make a better option than equity mutual funds for retirement, says Godrej Wadia. What do you have to say? Interesting question.
An interesting name. two big industries.
Yes. Talking about retirement.
Talking about NPS, of all things. Yes, NPS has become better, has improved. Earlier, there was, you know, NPS works that you accumulate your savings till retirement, and when you turn 60, 40% of the money should be converted into an equity, into an annuity. 60% of the money you can take out, but that used to be taxable. Now it has become tax-free. So it has improved.
Hmm.
But the big difference between a mutual fund and the NPS is that you are the owner of your money in mutual fund.
Right.
And you are not full complete owner of your money in NPS.
Mm.
All your accumulation, 40%, has to be converted into annuity, which will generate that pension. And also, you don't have a complete say on the asset allocation or the way it is invested. Of course, NPS has one significant advantage, that it is the lowest cost managed investment product in the country. But despite that, so that's one thing. I would say that, you know, NPS has improved. But having control on my money, because I don't trust anybody to be entrusted a good part of my lifetime accumulation and derive money on account of pension. Because, and I visualize that, you know, in next 5, 10, 15 years, NPS will actually become even, you know, will provide greater flexibility. It has happened in the UK already.
Okay.
That investors have all the choice. They can mount a withdrawal plan. They can take all the money out if they want to, or they can buy annuity. Annuity is not thrust upon them. It is not a mandatory thing. And I think the way NPS is moving, freeing things, what it had to get from the government, it has already got that.
Okay.
Now, you know, freeing that, maybe for government employees, it can still be mandatory. But for people who are investing and making a discretionary choice, having greater flexibility in what happens to their money, if, as and when it happens, NPS will be an even superior product. NPS has improved, but it is not all that great even now.
Amit Rajsen says, I have recently retired and would like to generate a fixed income of 25,000 rupees every month for my expenses. Please suggest a suitable avenue. We've been discussing this.
And you know, this is something, as I was saying, that, you know, you have two phases of life.
Mm.
One phase in which you are accumulating and the other phase in which you are deriving income to support yourself. Two things, Amit. One is that your need of 25,000 rupees a month translates into an annual need of 3 lakh rupees. And 3 lakh rupees is good enough now, but next year, maybe you need 3.5 lakh rupees or
right.
3 lakh, 25,000 rupees. On account of inflation, your needs go up even in retirement, because expenses don't stop because you have retired. So, or you know, the cost doesn't stop rising.
Hmm.
So, you have to plan your investments in a manner that you not only get 25,000 rupees a month today, which is 3 lakh rupees a year, but next year it goes up marginally to support need for higher income. For this, there are 2-3 vehicles, you know, if I have to give you a simple plan. I don't know how much accumulation you have, how much money you have to invest. But assuming that 3 lakh rupees is your need, then a very conservative plan should be deriving 5% of your capital. And of so if you have 60 lakh rupees, 5% of 60 lakh rupees is 3 lakh. So if you have 60 lakh rupees, it can support 3 lakh rupees. And I think, you know, something like a balanced fund or a balanced advantage fund, which with a 50% allocation to equity and debt, will ensure that you not only get 3 lakh rupees, but every year there is a possibility, every 2-3 years, that you will be able to grow your income, because the capital will also go up when you are deriving this. And that is one problem which everybody has to worry, that your need for income You have to invest in a manner that your need for, not only your need for income is supported, but this kind of plan will ensure that you never run the risk of outliving your savings. Because the moment your capital stops growing, you will start eating into the capital.
Correct.
And then you will consume most of it. So, and you know, the plan which I'm suggesting, that if you have 60 lakh rupees and if you derive 3 lakh rupees every year, and you should be able to, you know,
Balanced fund is what you're saying.
Balanced fund or equity income fund, equity savings fund to begin with. Because, you know, a person like him will also be very nervous. And if you have no experience of market-linked investments, then it could be traumatic when you see investments going down by 5-10% every few months. So mount a systematic withdrawal plan on this. And this lump sum of 60 lakh rupees, if it has to be invested, then you have to ensure that it is invested over a period of 18 months to 36 months, 1.5 to 3 years, because this is a very crucial money. You cannot risk your capital to the risk of catching a market high.
So then, what if somebody is already invested and would like to now plan for the retirement and withdraw the money every month, as he's mentioning, 25,000? What should that person do?
Mount a systematic withdrawal plan on your investments.
Okay.
And make sure that your withdrawal rate is not exceeding 5-6% in the initial years. In fact, in all times, because the idea is that 5-6% of a capital, if you just take 5-6% and you're, then you will get an opportunity. You leave a lot of your capital to grow in years when market goes up, and market is going to be inconsistent for all times to come. So you have the possibility of, you know, deriving higher income in future, and ensuring that you are not withdrawing more than 5-6% will also reduce the possibility of eating into your capital, which is a great risk. You will be staring at the risk of, you know, outliving your savings very quickly if you eat into your capital by, you know, if you start withdrawing 10%, 12% in a year like 2018, then you'll just be left with 90% or 80% of your capital. And as your capital goes up in few years' time, because markets will be inconsistent, have this conservative withdrawal policy. It will be taken care of by, you know, your capital going up and higher income that can be derived in future.
Okay. So that's all we have in today's Q&A. And as we are on the verge of saying hello to 2019, ensure that no matter what the market circumstances, no matter how much the volatility or the elections, as everyone is thinking about, you continue to invest, is what Dhiren is saying. Right, Dhiren?
Right there.
So have a wonderful 2019 as we step into it and continue to invest. From all of us here at Value Research, we wish you a very happy new year.